Hi all, welcome to another episode of Saturday Architecture. And if you like the content that what we are sharing, and if you like what you are hearing, and you would like to be informed of this, either follow us on LinkedIn or subscribe to the YouTube button. Either way, you will know that there is some new content waiting for you. And please do give feedback and comments on what you would like to hear more, or you want more details. Please do that, it helps us. Thank you. Today we have Sanjay Narang. He is a very experienced cloud architect, and he has kind of come up with an approach of five pillars to doing cloud architecture. Now, architecture has different components, and architecture, cloud architecture itself has its own specialties, right? We need to look at how you develop a desktop application or a mainframe application or a client server application. The architectures for that kind of differ from a cloud architecture. And it is, let's say, an evolution of architecture. Now, what does that evolution mean? How does those architecture components which looked in the traditional world, how does it look with respect to the cloud is what we would look at. Thanks, Sanjay, for joining us. And we would have this as, we will start off with an introduction to what he call as the cloud corpse, which I have put here. And so that I just put it there so that we remember that. And then there are those five pillars, right? COR, and we will delve into each of them in the coming episodes. Okay. So thanks, Sanjay, for taking the time and the effort to put something together and sharing with us. We also have Deepak from Microsoft, Venkat from AquaConnect, and Nishant from IBS joining us. Okay. So Sanjay, thanks again. And why did you want to do this cloud corpse? So I guess let's start from there, right? I mean, there are dime a dozen architecture books and AWS, you name it, right? Google, everybody has their own stuff. Why did you have to spend time on creating something like this? What was your motivation?
Yes, absolutely. So in my organization, I work with a lot of architects in terms of how are they doing architecture for their applications, how we can improve things and things like that. And you know, I also have been focusing on a multi-cloud. So interestingly, what I saw is in year 2020, for example, in May 2020, Google Cloud launched what they call as a cloud architecture framework.
Okay.
So I realized, okay, this is, as you said, right? Every organization has some kind of a framework that was their cloud architecture framework. I looked at it, that's fine. Sometime in July, Microsoft launched what they call as a well-architected framework, Azure well-architected framework. I looked at it, and then when I looked at what is based on, the names looked exactly same what was there in Google Cloud, little bit of reference. And then I did little more search, and I realized AWS had their well-architected framework for a long time.
Okay.
So Microsoft not only use the name exactly as it is in AWS, but they also used pillars exactly same. Okay, and those pillars or the basic principles of that cloud architecture framework are these five that I've mentioned as a cloud corpse, right? So cost is, C is for cost optimization, O is for operational excellence, R is for reliability, and P is for performance efficiency, and S is for security. Now, so that was intriguing that how come three different cloud providers, they have their own native services, give a similar in terms of the functionality, but they have their own native services, whether it is databases, whether it is a compute, whether it is AIML, how can they agree on exact same names or cloud architecture, right? So that was one. And the way it came to me, it was this kind of surprise. And then when I started looking at it, each of them had a very good content inside that. And then I dig a little deeper into that, and it was not only the well-architected framework, there are a lot of tools and resources which are available on that, and it makes sense to not only use this well-architected framework for your applications when you're developing, but even look at other sources, not only for the cloud that you're building. It makes sense to kind of learn what is there in other cloud, so that you can see what others are guiding you, because these principles are not specific to cloud, they're architecture principles which are agnostic to cloud. So that's where I said, okay, it's a good material to kind of share with people, they know about it, and the COPS just came as a regular common outcome of that, so it's easy to remember mnemonic, so that's why I kind of wrote it.
It's pretty catchy, and you kind of came up with that corpse stuff.
Yes, I can.
Easier to think and keep it. So the mind likes simplicity, right? And I think it's easy to say corpse rather than five principles of cloud architecture, think about it kind of a thing.
And if you look at the word corpse, right, it has a meaning in English. Basically, its definition is from military time. When a group of people work together for a common purpose, that's kind of a corpse.
Oh, okay.
Cloud corpse.
That's a nice connection. Okay. So I got the motivation.
The military pronunciation is they call it the core. Instead, they don't call it corpse, they just call it core. Okay. Because I was thinking that this relates to military somehow, but I couldn't place it there. Now I realize.
So it's kind of interesting. So the common goal obviously is the favorite thing in what we call, right? How does the solutions that we do really deliver value to the end customer? I think that's the common goal. And from what you're telling, I kind of understand that even though you have different technologies, when you look at it as corpse, the knowledge that a person gains can be used regardless of the technology or the service provider at the back end. And it also kind of, in a way, it kind of also builds a little bit of technology independence in the architecture that you are building, so that you are not dependent on a particular provider. I mean, with cloud, there is, I think it's a kind of oxymoron to say, I will not depend on a cloud. Because then if you do that, then you don't really get the benefit of that. So it becomes a tricky thing. So going ahead, right? Let's say in an actual project, right? Like, let's say I'm going to start off on a project, or I have got an existing application. Like in my case, right, I would say that I have an application which is running for 5 years now, and I'm developing a newer application. Or Venkat here, his application is like 2 years old. Nishant is actually probably little longer, decades old kind of a thing. And there are three scenarios. I think for me and Venkat, being a startup, everything started off on the cloud. But I guess one of the challenges still is that I'm not sure about Venkat's architecture. Mine architecture is more like an infrastructure service. I still use a little bit of cloud services in a true cloud sense, right? As a PaaS or as a SaaS, not even a SaaS, it's as a PaaS. How does this, or let's say I have a legacy application which I need to shift to cloud, right? How do we start with this, right? How do you get into thinking about this? For example, the different pillars, right? Cost optimizations or operations excellence. It's, as a person who is on the floor, okay? This thing seems not my job. I'm here to make that functionality work. I think Venkat would agree with me. His CEO comes and says, I want this click feature on that, okay? So that is where the mind tends to go towards. Okay. How do you fit this in? How do you start?
Yeah. So before we even get into that, right? So if you look at it, the key principles, take cost optimization, which is more specific to cloud. The other four are not something new. You should remember we used to call FURPS, that HP term, functionality, usability, reliability, performance, and supportability. And when I was doing a little bit of more research on how can these companies come up with the same principles, I looked at some more standards, a consortium of software quality, CISC, and then ISO 25001. If you go there, these pillars are also there with some little bit of different names, but they are exactly there. So what I'm kind of trying to say is, whether it is on-prem word or a classic old word, this thing, other than the cost thing, more or less other things are same that we have been doing as architects for a long time. What used to be called supportability, I think that it's being called as operational excellence here. But if you look at it, security, it has been always important. Reliability, it has been always important. And performance has been always important, right? So those things, I guess we do not have much challenge, right? How do we pick on those three things, reliability, security, and performance? That we have been doing as an architect for all the applications, whether it is deployed on-prem, in hybrid, or on cloud. Now, when it comes to cloud, cost becomes an important part. We have spoken it earlier also, right? Many people start doing cloud because of cost, but that has a different angle to it. But if you do the book, one of the major thing is it is pay as you.
Yeah, go ahead.
So we were saying about cost, right? One key difference of cloud from on-prem is it is pay as you. And if you really need to optimize your workloads, you need to kind of keep that in mind that when I go to cloud, I am paying as you go, which is whatever I use, I have to pay for that, and I can stop that. So that's what we need to kind of do. For example, and all these cloud providers, right, they are also business models to earn more and more consumption, because the more consumption they will have, the more revenue they will have. So many of the technologies have been built for that, right? If you do not keep that in mind, if you do not architect an application right, you can actually end up spending a lot. I'll give you a couple of examples. Cosmos DBs, a very reliable multi-geo, multi-distributed database supporting NoSQL databases for MongoDB or DocumentDB. If you simply put your MongoDB into Cosmos, it will create almost multiple collections. And multiple collections can cost different, for each collection there could be different cost for that. If you don't architect it well, you might end up paying much more than you were expecting to do.
Okay.
Another example is whether it's AWS, and AWS has something called for their logging, then StackDriver is in Google Cloud, and Application Insight is there in Azure. We all like logging in our applications, and if you remember, we had best practices like put the mode as debug, info, error, those things, right? I remember I was working with a customer when I was at Microsoft. They suddenly came to us and they said, we have got a huge bill in Application Insights. What we realized is, that person had a lot of debug logging statements, and they switched on a flag to push all that to Application Insight. And it's it's not a small amount. In Indian rupees, it's still, it was in terms of 12 lakh rupees.
Wow, okay.
Right?
And I think the important point there to be noted is 12 lakhs for no value. You pay 12 lakhs for nothing, literally.
Exactly.
Okay.
So that's the reason that when we move to cloud, I think the cost plays an important role, and we need to, as a developer also, we need to kind of take care of that. For example, of this logging, right? We do that. So that's about cost.
Nice. Okay.
And similar things we can think of from an operational excellence perspective. Now, if you look at, we all are moving towards Agile and DevOps. So one of the few key things, principles about operational excellence is, how do we kind of automate things and make it more run on their own? DevOps played an important role there. But in addition to DevOps, again, coming back to developers, cloud recommends us, or I mean, we are more inclined to go into microservices kind of architecture, serverless kind of architecture, which is a little different from what we used to do in on-prem. What it happens is you will have multiple microservices running across. Now, how do you troubleshoot? In an on-prem and a monolithic app, you used to have a one big log file. You can look at the log file and see, okay, what is this thing? But let us say you have 10 different microservices. How do you, you know, troubleshoot? Okay. And each of the microservices can be running in multiple instances. So how can you make a centralized logging and have something which provides a transaction ID so that you can track, okay, this transaction has gone from this microservice to other microservice, and on this, there is absolutely no way for you to troubleshoot that, right?
Okay.
Now, again, as a developer, so when we are writing the code, we also need to understand that, are we omitting enough instrumentation that if this application goes wrong, will I be able to troubleshoot? So that's, I think, those are the additional hacks that I need to wear when we developing
cloud. I think that's a great point, because when you write, let's say, even as an infrastructure as a service or on-prem, I would assume that the logs will come in sequence. Two things gets called, it will get logged because I'm writing to the same file. But in this case, they will get created as separate logs itself. Interesting. Yes. Go on.
Just a question on the cost. So what you're suggesting on cost is that this is something which now the architects and the developers have to start caring about more than what they used to when they were on premises, because on premises it's like a sunk cost, and it's like once you're given a resource, it's yours and you use it whatever way you want. And now, because it's pay as you use sort of a scenario, you have to be more careful, and this sort of adds another dimension for architects to consider much more closely than what they were used to before.
Yes, absolutely, Deepak. That is one thing. And if you look at that landscape that I have put in the article for the Cloud Co-ops, right? There are additional tools that cloud providers are providing. So AWS has something called Trusted Advisor. Azure has something called Azure Advisor. Now, they provide you some help on that. So if, let us say, you have already deployed an architecture and application in cloud, these tools continue to scan and give you some kind of recommendations. Now, one of the area of the recommendation is cost. In fact, if you look at Azure Advisor, all the areas are very much aligned to the COPS. So even in Azure Advisor, AWS has a little bit different. I'm suspecting that they might also kind of align it towards that, but cost is this. Now, in that, what happens is it can give you recommendations, something like similar. If it's a compute, very easy that this VM has not been utilized. For example, let's say VM is getting utilized less than 5% or 10%. They said maybe you can reduce the size of the VM to reduce the cost.
Okay.
And then we know that in cloud, we have something called reserved instances, that if we reserve it for a year, we can pay much lesser. All providers provide that. Now, it also will give you a recommendation that you have been running it for more than 3 months. Why don't you kind of do a reservation so that you can pay much lesser? Okay. And I'm telling only for compute, but the similar recommendations are there for other, like SQL and things like that. So yes, absolutely, Deepak. I think this is another hack that we need to wear as an architect when we're developing applications in cloud.
So I think for people like me or Venkat, right, who have been using cloud services, being there, at a bare minimal thing, I would say, run the advisor and just see what it throws up. I mean, that could be a simple starting point. Just curious, is it like a wizard that you just go into your AWS or Azure instance and run it and see?
Yeah, I believe it is just it's an option which shows up. It says these are the recommendations for you, and usually it will show up in notifications also if you turn it on.
Yeah. So it's a service. I mean, I'll call it it's a service. It's a free service. Most of the things are free available. So you just go to that service. I guess it is by default on. So you just go there and look at. So it will provide you recommendation in all those areas.
That's a great tip to start.
In fact, most providers now give you an hook into your ticketing system if you want to see the recommendation should generate a ticket so that you get to action it also. So you can do that kind of integration also if you want. So you can get into ServiceNow or, I don't know, CA or some of these tools. So it gives a web hook, I believe. You can turn it into maybe a Teams hook also if you want.
Okay.
You can give recommendations into that.
Yeah. And then... And these are also available as an API. So for example, right, in a large organization, and these recommendations are generally subscription based. So each subscription, you have to look at it. Now, in a large organization, any enterprise, you will be dealing with thousands of subscriptions. So how do you go about kind of looking at all? So this is something that, for example, I've seen large organizations are doing that. They're writing APIs and looking for these recommendations and put it in a central place. And then they go and start looking at it, because the DevOps engineers for that team or the architects for that team may or may not look at it, because many of times those could be false positive. For example, right, I know that I'm not going with reserved instances. This is for 3 months, and after 3 months I may not need this, but tool doesn't know about it, right? So I just can't take it. So, but it's important to at least go and look at it. So at a macro level, so the APIs come handy for that.
Okay. So moving on to the next pillar, right? We covered cost, and then we covered optimization. Then moving on to reliability. Now, reliability is a given in cloud, right? So what is special? In fact, it'll be a lot more easier if I go on cloud. So what is the key point there?
My experience is you'll be surprised how reliable the cloud is or isn't.
Okay.
So, I generally take an example there. Storage, right? So, if you look at clouds, have three core services: compute, storage, and networking, and everything else is built on top of these. Now, storage, for example, again, I'll take an example of Azure storage. Right from beginning, I mean, for years, they had something called globally redundant storage, which means is they store three copies of that, whatever storage you have in the region that you've created, and three more copies they will keep in a region which is miles away, which they call as a peer region. And as you said, right, so people thought that is given. Azure is giving me that reliability by default. What is it I need to do? People did not know, for so far they will be able to access the remote region only when Microsoft will declare that their primary region is down. And in the history of cloud, there has not been an instance when any cloud provider, I would say three, I'm not sure about others, AWS, Google, and Azure, they have not declared so far region as down. There have been outages, which are, you know, could be 8 hours, could be 12 hours, but they are able to recover the region that they have never declared a region. So, because the other region is available when you are using GRS, only when Microsoft declares the region down. So, and it may happen in 24 hours, it may happen in 48 hours. They have not given an SLA for that, how long they will take to declare region. Because if region is declared, it's a huge work for a cloud provider to move everything to a different region.
Okay.
Now, if you need an application, and let us say your recovery time objective or RTO is 4 hours or 8 hours, you cannot rely on that. You need to build your own mechanism to say that when I'm not outage is happening for 8 hours in one region, I need to go and start doing something on the other region, right?
So just on that point, right? Now, does that mean that the cloud services, the RTO is not defined?
No, they have defined, right? So,
but for this, they have an SLA. They have an SLA, not exactly an RTO for your specific
service
instance, right? So they have an SLA for the availability, but RTO is a very specific to an application, I would say.
Okay.
We can derive it from there. But the thing is, it's an agreement, right? Service level agreement. In SRE world, we generally will go with SLO, which is service level objective. But if you look at it, see, if they do not meet an SLA, they will give you some financial compensation for that. But for my critical application, I'm not depending on a financial this thing. I need to have my own business continuity planning there.
Okay. Now,
coming back, right? But then these cloud providers give you other options. For example, building on Azure case, right? The GRS thing. They have an they came up with an option called RAGRS, which is read-only GRS, which means if a region goes, there is another region which is available, and you can access that storage as a read-only always. It is a different endpoint. So your application should have a code to kind of access.
Switch. Oh, okay.
And now recently they have come up with a feature where actually you can initiate a failover to another region. You don't have to depend on even for GRS. You don't have to kind of wait for Microsoft to declare
that. It is like the active passive clustering in SQL, which we used to do in the olden days, similar to that.
Which is basically, you can do a manual failover in this case. Right?
Okay.
Now they have come up with the option. So many years they did not have this option.
Okay.
So as an architect, right? For every service that I have, I need to be sure that what options I have for reliability, in what context they work, and then design my application accordingly. Mm-hmm. Whether I use RAGRS or whether I use auto failover or manual failover, that's
those are good examples.
I have an example which actually relates to what just Sanjay described. So one of the customers who actually was running an on-prem SQL instance and had all their microservices talking to SQL Server and all those things, they moved to the cloud. And suddenly they started facing timeout issues and says, now your SQL Server is not necessarily sitting right next to your other rack, which is having your microservices Apache instances running, right? So where you have microsecond
latency
sort of response is guaranteed. You're not even have code inside your applications to handle timeouts. So that is the kind of things which you have, which happens to you when you sort of move. The reliability factor changes completely. And so it's like having new infrastructure. So you can't just think about it as you think about it when you are doing on premises. So you can't just, but this is a common problem with all this lift and shift kind of
migration
deployment migrations. Yeah,
interesting. I think
reliability may actually, so you, to answer your previous question, the reliability may actually go down if you do the lift and shift and don't think about all the things which Sanjay mentioned.
Interesting. Okay.
And those patterns, whether it is a retry pattern or whether it is a circuit breaker, they become very important when we doing something in cloud.
Okay. So covering the two more pillars, right? I think. Okay. So I think now I will not make that statement. Performance efficiency. I thought you go to cloud, it will perform well because we have separate for each instance and it's good. And obviously, I know that I'm wrong from your previous explanation. So how does this matter, right? Like, because it scales up, I have given it a high, a high capacity for that specific workload. Previously, I had on-prem, I had one server four applications sharing that. Here it's not by the nature how I've done it, each one gets a separate VM or a separate, like let's say it's a Lambda kind of a separate instance which is there, then there is no conflict and technically it is supposed to be optimally performing already by the way that I'm deploying. So what's the catch here?
Yes. So if you look at it, right, how we code, right, independent of where it's deployed, code needs to take care of that, is it performing well or not. Now, some examples, for example, ultimate in cloud, again, coming to the cost thing, right, even performance comes at cost, right? Disk that you're using, IOPS of a disk, you have to pay more for getting the higher IOPS, right? And then you can scale up and scale down according to that. Similarly for the compute. So when you go and look at even this option, so which, that is more from an infrastructure perspective, that which disk I need to use, which kind of compute, okay? Because it's all pay as you go, that's one.
Okay.
Second thing is, those principles that we have been doing even in on-prem but do not change. For example, if you're using a SQL in an application, you are supposed to use, you know, connection pools to optimize your connections to SQL. If you do not do that, you may exhaust from that. Right? How do you remember that? So that still you need to kind of take care of those aspects, because look at it. What is cloud? Cloud is a data center managed by someone else at basic level.
It's still okay.
I'm not managing the data center. So another example I will give you. So serverless is very popular these days, and Lambda is one serverless function capability from AWS. A lot of people are using it. Now, how does serverless work? What they do is, whenever you write some code, they bring up the compute which they manage. And you know they run it, and if you are not using that particular code or function, they will bring down that infrastructure.
Okay.
Now we all know what is a cold start, right?
Yes. Okay.
When the application comes, this cold start is actually a problem in serverless. You need to still manage that. If I'm using a serverless and I do not call that code, that whatever the compute is, its cloud provider can bring that down, and next time I run, it will take all that time to bring the code in the memory to get all that, and your application will suffer.
Now, okay.
So those are things that we still need to take care of.
I think it's kind of interesting, right? Now the fourth pillar and the first pillar kind of go, one influences the other. So if I'm going to say, don't put my Lambda in hibernate, my cost will go up.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
And if I kind of say, for reducing cost, I will not turn on that flag, then when a particular user comes and clicks on search, the application will sleep for 5 seconds.
They're all interrelated. You have to see, okay, what is making sense for your application, right? Even for reliability, for example. Now, depending on, you don't need that kind of a reliability for every application. It's okay that sometimes applications can go down. For example, the application could be just a back-end job. And there are some services like batch services or preemptible compute. So if you use a preemptible compute from the cloud provider, they charge you much lesser. But what it means is, you're running something and cloud provider is short of capacity, they can kill your, whatever you're running.
Oh, okay.
So you allow yourself to be killed, basically.
Exactly.
So they make it cheaper for you.
They make it cheaper. Now, if your application is, which is some kind of a batch processing, you can actually use that, right? So,
you have to architect it such that it can recover from failure, right? So exactly. Then you have to write code for it.
Correct. So you reduce your reliability, you increase your cost efficiency. And so these are all related. So these are trade-offs that you have to make for these.
Okay. Last pillar. I won't make any statement. You tell. What's the catch with security? What's the anti-pattern that we typically get into?
Exactly. Now, security again becomes quite important in public clouds, especially. Now, security was always important, but if you look at it, most of the applications that we were building initially, they will be put it in our secured environment. Network used to provide us a default security. Now, when you go to cloud, what is another definition of a cloud? Cloud is available on internet from anywhere. Now, when that is the surface area which is open to internet from everywhere, the surface area for attacks becomes quite heavy, quite large, right? So you need to be aware of that. So sometimes, for example, I've seen people saying that this is my dev environment, I'm not concerned about it. But that is your dev environment. For a cloud provider, they're giving you their production environment, whether it is cloud and all that. If someone hacks into your dev environment, one example that I remember from this thing is, so there was a team who was building their dev environment. They created a new kind of a subscription. They were trying out various things and that. One of account which was kind of an administrator account on the cloud got compromised. And when that account got compromised, the hacker used that account and they started spinning up machines of 64 CPUs multiple times, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and they started doing crypto mining in that.
Wow. Okay.
In two hours, the bill was $400K USD.
Wow. Okay.
So you were thinking it's a dev environment. Yeah, nothing is going to happen to you, your data in dev environment. But if someone get access to your cloud, they can even do that. I'm just giving one example, right? And other things which is, you know, WASP or SQL injection, cross-site scripting, all those things are still valid. You need to have your web application firewall, your regular firewalls, your port, this thing. I'm not even coming to that. But I'm just giving another example that a very simple thing can, you know, create such a big problem.
That's actually a very interesting perspective, right? Like, I think on-prem, we are mentally telling, you know, I have only so much resource. The only thing which I can look at is security is somebody is going to come and take my data, right? And I would say, you know what, I have insignificant data in my app. It is just that somebody just telling what food they ate in the morning or some photographs. If somebody wants to take it, let it take it and go. Anyway, it's public data. But it's not just that. The other thing is something like they could do something completely different. And the case that you said is very interesting. Now, this is a vulnerability any cloud consumer could do. And interestingly, I think it gets tricky because most of the cloud are prepaid or postpaid services, right? I think, I'm not even sure, just a general question. Do we have something like a prepaid or you can set an upper limit to consumption, right? Could be that is, I mean, it's just a shortcut, but then I guess, I'm not too sure, two questions. Is there a
prepaid? I'll answer that question for you. There are two things. One is, what do you expect the cloud provider to do once you exceed that bill, right? So for example, let's you put an upper limit and say, okay, if I start consuming more than this, just put a stop to everything. So what it does is it causes a sort of a denial of service for you yourself, right? You may deny your own service because somebody just started consuming your main service, which you are paying really it for, that gets stopped. So cloud providers try to prevent this from happening, right? So even if you reach that limit, they will let you go further, right? So that is a reason not to put such limits for yourself. Means that you may deny yourself some service. You can put alerts and things like that, which probably most cloud providers will give you. But putting a hard limit on something, you may hurt yourself. So that is one angle to that.
Exactly. So just on that, right? So that, I mean, some cloud providers call
it's
that.
It's like I have a credit card without an upper limit.
So there is a possibility of a spend limit. But that most of the enterprise deals, when you are doing an enterprise agreement with a cloud provider, that capability is not even available to you. I mean, you can't even put a spend limit for those kind of subscriptions. You can only do alerts. You can do alerts.
Oh, okay.
Okay. So it's not available on each kind of subscription that you have. So actually, you know, that's the problem, right? It can go, you know.
So again, yes links to the C, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
So one question I have for Sanjay is the one factor which I sort of did not find in the all the five pillars which you mentioned was control, right? So the amount of control you have over your infrastructure, over your application, it drastically changes once you go from on-prem to the cloud or even multi-cloud. And it may be different for different cloud vendors or maybe more or less similar, but how do you address the control part? When I say control, it means when I was on-prem, I had control over almost every aspect of my application. I can decide I want more disk, I can buy more.
Flip it around to say autonomy.
Yeah. Let's say
as an application developer, I had more autonomy or less autonomy, whatever you want to call it, right?
Yeah. So where do you address that in the pillars, Ms.? Maybe I'm missing that point.
So in fact, you know, in cloud world, another word that we use for control is called governance, right? Now, in fact, you need governance in each of these pillars. How is your cost going? You need to have a control there, right? How is your monitoring happening? What is your security? What people can do, what people cannot do is all embedded. Now, cloud providers provide features for that. For example, you can have a control saying that my people cannot provision a VM bigger than this. There is a policy available, there is a structure available for cost angle. Similarly, from security, you can say that you can put a policy that my developers or my cloud engineers cannot open port 22 or, you know, 3389 for RDP on that. So you can put that as a policy. And same applies to other things, right? So it is embedded in each of that. Cloud providers provide those features, and we need to be aware of that to use them.
Interesting. And I think one of the things which, as I'm hearing, right, we started off with telling that microservices is what we do. Maybe the other starting point is take these five pillars and look at it from each microservice. I think that would be a great starting point. Like probably on-prem or infrastructure as a service, we were doing it at an app level or at a server level. So now in a cloud world, it would kind of make sense to take these things and look at it as each microservice, assuming that your microservice and business is aligned. Okay, that's a different topic altogether, whether they are aligned, but assuming that they are well aligned, then it would kind of make sense to kind of look at it like take each microservice and then see how much or what are the tick boxes, right? For each microservice, for each pillar, how much I have filled it. I think that would be another easy way to get into this thinking, our architects.
Absolutely. Because if you look at definition of a microservice, it's a specialized component built for a purpose. It's doing its purpose. And what you said is absolutely we need to do at each microservice level. But at the same time, if you remember, we used to call integration testing and the system testing. You also need to do a system level. Right? They're working together. Am I managing them all together? That also we need to do.
Interesting. Venkat, Nishant, any doubts, questions, thoughts?
So one thing, I just wanted to ask actually. So as you said, cost, So is it really cost will be reducing for in terms of when we go for the higher traffic or resources? Because one of my friends' company, they are to reduce the cost, so they wanted to shift from their own premises to AWS. And instead of reducing cost, after 1 year, they are realizing that they are spending millions of dollars more actually.
So I think that is exactly Sanjay's point.
Now they are coming back to our on-premises. Yeah, so they are started cutting
reverse migration.
On-premises. Yes.
Absolutely. I think many people go with that inclination that if I go to cloud, I will save the cost. But I've been telling, there's another article that I wrote for, you know, not only for cloud, that can multi-cloud really save your cost, but independent of whether it's multi-cloud or cloud, right? Cost should not be your driving factor. I think cloud gives us many other things, which is agility, innovation, the scale. There are things which we are can do right now in terms of, you know, data analytics and machine learning, which we are never able to do that in on-prem, but because of this thing. So I think those needs to be driver, and cost should be a factor that, okay, whether I will be paying additional cost, or can I reduce cost? Can reduce cost in some instances. For example, pay as you go is a typical example, right? Right. For a seasonal workload, you can always save cost. In fact, I remember I was working for a very large, I was helping a very large ITS customer. They had an appraisal app, and appraisal app, and we know, you know, appraisal happens only towards, last week or last day. And every time that used to happen, that application used to go down. They had 50 servers for that application. And you can think of, right? We moved that to platform as a service. We reduced cost to 1/4, and we used to scale up that application only for those quarterly seasons and all that, right? So those are opportunities for you to save cost. But that should not come as a driving factor. It's not that every time you will save cost. So it depends on your workload and your business objectives.
Okay, got it. Yeah, thanks, Sanjay.
Nishant? Thoughts, doubts, questions?
Yes. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, so my perspective is basically my main story is like what
audio is not good.
Yeah, your audio is breaking.
Now?
Yeah, better.
Yeah, what all things or what all additional points we need to consider when we have to migrate a big monolithic applications to a cloud platform, monolithic application running in an on-prem to a cloud platform? Because I think we have mentioned so many points here, like the scopes covers most of the things, and my basic question is like, I assume few of the points that we discussed, like this the point that we covered using this terminology corps, actually should be considered for a non-cloud or an architecture point of view, like this the points that developer has to take care, like this time out things and so many things, that is a mandatory things for even for an application running in an on-prem. So when we have to migrate an application running an on-prem to a cloud, what all points or do we can say like these all are the additional checklist kind of things that we need to check when we start thinking migrating an application from an on-prem to a cloud platform?
Sure, Nishant. So as you said, and as we discussed earlier also, right? Not, these are not new. The COPS things are not necessarily new thing for a cloud world, except for cost thing, I think, which we not taking care. Most other things have been consistent even in on-prem, and we need to take care of that. But few other things that I would say is, in cloud, what I generally say is small is beautiful. So look at your applications where you can scale horizontally in small applications, you will be better off. In on-prem world, we used to do scale up, increase the size and all that, but scale out is a better option in cloud. And when we are, and that's what I've seen in many applications when we migrate, is the applications have not been built for a scale out. For example, they might be using in-memory sessions, they might be use, they might be depending on sticky sessions of a load balancer, things like that, right? And those are very common. I think if you can take care of those, in addition to what we discussed, that should help us.
I think that point which you said is kind of, I think one of the typical and I would say hidden denier of benefit of cloud is the database. You will have multiple servers, you will have multiple services, okay? And we would say, you know, our application is microservices. But all the guys will come to one DB. You have 10 microservices and each of them will fight to put a lock on that user table. Each microservice will do a join.
In microservices work, that's a, you know, this thing, database design is debated a lot. So there are two variants, whether we should use a common database, as you were saying, or each service should own their own database. Now, there are pros and cons for both, but because we, if you go with the principle of a microservice, every service should be independent and, you know, self-sustained and autonomous. From that perspective, it is important that that service should own their data also. But when you split your data into multiple microservices, you will get into issues of consistency. Okay, that's where, and then there are things like, you know, patterns like CQRS and all we talk about. I mean, there are, I mean, we can take that in another topic, but there are patterns to kind of ensure that, you know, when your data is distributed, how do we kind of ensure consistency between that?
I think that would probably come under the R pillar. R and P, right? R and P would be a contribution to that. Okay.
Yeah, here also, I think if you are going to follow this, your microservice principle, then keeping separate DB for each microservice, again, it will have that cost impact, right? So, my doubt is for this microservice, is it a priority to keep separate schema for each microservice, or like we can have a, we should maintain separate DB itself?
Yeah, that's interesting. So Nishant, I mean, what I generally recommend is, I'm not saying database, I'm saying each service should have their own data. Okay. Now, as you said, right, it could be same database, but there could be different tables which are owned by a different thing, right? Sometimes service should own their master data, but as a read-only, it should be available to anyone. So there are patterns around that. So there is no right and wrong thing. It will depend a lot on the workload that you are developing and, you know, what is expected. But these are the things that you need.
I think, Nishant, one other thing is when you start looking at data, the thinking becomes easier rather than database. So let's say I have a batch job to be run. Okay. I can think of, let's say I just talked about the user table, right? Which is typically, or the master table. Okay. We could just take a couple of master tables and move that into a Cosmo or a MongoDB kind of a thing, which is a NoSQL. My core can still be a SQL DB. But what the microservices needs can be in a cloud version of data storage. So I think that's another way of looking at it, right? So only when that comes up will that instances be used. And then I think it also comes to, if it's less reliable, is it okay? So even if it's, there's something called eventual consistency, right? I think we are an architect, we would know that. So if a microservice is okay with eventual consistency, then it helps.
And another thing which comes common in the design for failures, for a fail-safe design, if you remember, it was one very important microservice or something like that. So I think you need to expect failures. That's another thing, and then build according to that.
Okay, and actually, whoever coming to cloud, you know, for the first time, actually they will take everything as a granted. So like, no, they are not employing right people, and whatever they want to do, no. So this is a cloud, you can do anything, they take care of, you please do it. No, so this kind of mindset is the people are having. So what do you want to, you know, tell them, like?
So you can't tell them.
So they can very simply tell them, don't rely on the cloud. Okay, so be even more cautious. I would actually take that, right? Because it's hard to tell people that, you know, look for this, look for this, look for this, look for that. So the general thing, easiest communication is to say, you think cloud is secure? It is not.
Yeah.
So look at all the corps. Okay. You think it's going to be cost efficient? It is not. You think it has, it can be operated easily? It is not. You think it's reliable? No, it is not. Do you think it will give you maximum performance? No, it won't. Security will it give? No, it won't. So basically say, corps will not be available to you. Think about it. I think that's an easy place to start with.
Yes, and I will just add to that, right, what Deepak was saying earlier, control and governance. So it's always a trade-off between innovation and control. If you stop people, they will not, you know, think a lot, they will not be able to do a lot. But those governance controls that cloud provider provide, as a centralized IT, you can make sure of that, take care of that, and then let people do that. So to what level you want to give the freedom is a trade-off, but make use of those centralized governance tools.
Okay. So thanks, great discussion. And I think, Sanjay, we will delve into each one, right? Each one is a separate ocean by itself. And I think it's pretty exciting to look at it this way. It gives a lot more structure to how we need to think about it with respect to architecture. And I think if I kind of connect it to my ISA pillars also, right, the five pillars. So essentially, it is kind of all these things kind of have a connection to each one, right? So, and they're all interconnected again. So if I just say from a business perspective, if I look at it, right, the business perspective has impact on all the five. If I look at design, it has impact on all the five. If I look at the human dynamics of who is using it, what will be, again, it has impact on the five. So it is looks like the five pillars of ISA architecture, corps has an impact on each of the pillars. So it's like one permutation combination that comes in. And I think that's another thing that we could go on. I think we need to pick more of your brains and probably take each one and do justice to that. We would look at that. So moving on to the last section, right, the key takeaways. To me, I think the key takeaway is many things. First and foremost, I would say that cloud, start off with thinking that the cloud does not give you corps. Set your mindset to say, I won't make an assumption that cloud will give me corps. Corps means working towards a common goal, and that common goal is end user success. So the corps have to be in alignment to deliver that. From a security perspective, I thought it is just my data. I had this personal thing, right? Oh, I don't have any significant data. Big deal. What are you going to do with it? But the point that you said, that a hacker can come and use instances, okay? And he can really run up my bill. Okay, now that is a very interesting skill which I hadn't thought of. Deepak?
All cloud providers are very similar. The architects cannot abdicate their architectural responsibilities. That is what I got out of it, right? That I'm just putting the onus on the architects. Architects cannot assume that just by going to the cloud, they will reduce their responsibility. In fact, it is increased in my view.
The cloud actually responsibility will increase. So we have to take caution on every steps which you are, you know, putting into, like, so we should not take it as a granted. We should have more cautions before, you know, deciding in it.
Doctors who is currently working in an on-prem world, when he has to jump into this cloud, or when he start thinking developing an application for a cloud, actually his workload is going to increase. Like, he has to consider this of things, start from the architecture design or the and invite that things to, or give that instructions. Starting from, down to all developers, like this corpse points should be taken care in all phases of the software development, especially when we design an application which is finally going to deploy in cloud. So such a culture has to be developed
So I just realized that we may be scaring away a lot of architects that don't go to the cloud. So I just want to add that there are now, just in terms of knowledge, of course, a lot of things are available, like what Sanjay, a new set of knowledge instead of the old set of knowledge. I would say, let's not scare people away that there's just like...
One of the objective of producing this, enable our architects that they have all these things. For example, I took an example of Advisor Tool, right? You can look at Advisor Tool and by default, the cloud provider is providing. So all those features are available. So one thing I would say is whichever cloud you're building the application, so there is a guidance from them, there is a framework from them, go and look at that. That will give you what you need. And not only look at that, also look at what other providers have. They can give you additional concepts on that. So that's what I would
look at your advisor within the service that you're using and look at the cloud. And I think that's a great starting point. Thanks all for joining. We will dwell deeper into each of the pillars in the coming episodes. Thank you.
Thank you.